have your Bibles, and I pray that you do, turn to Isaiah chapter 64 with me tonight. Isaiah chapter 64. And oh man, I thank y'all so much tonight for, man, delivering those words through a song with us. Isaiah chapter 64. As you're turning there, just in the spirit of humility, I just want to ask you a few things. And I think Cole and the guys and gals just sang about it. Have you ever found yourself literally where you felt like you were falling apart? You felt like you didn't have nowhere else to go. You didn't know where to go, and your life was literally falling apart right before your eyes. Have you ever asked yourself these questions? Where is God? Have you ever asked, man, where's God? Why is this happening to me? What I'm going through right now, why is this happening to me? How could this be? Why am I going through this? Why doesn't God just fix it? We want an easy fix it, God. Why doesn't God just fix it? When is God going to make it better? God, when are you going to make this better? Why is God not working when I'm praying? You ever caught yourself asking those questions? Why is God not working when I'm praying for it? Why isn't He working? Here's what we're saying, y'all. Whenever we're asking those questions, here's what we're saying. I'm desperate. I'm desperate. I'm desperate for something different in my life. I'm desperate. I got home last night, and I just tell you, I was unsettled as I've ever been before, and I sat in the words on my heart, and so I don't know where God's going to take it, but I've got some questions and some scripture, and I just pray that He speaks to some of us tonight, actually all of us tonight, because I know in my life I've asked a lot of those questions, Brother Kim. I know in my life I felt like it was falling apart before, and you know what? In desperation we cry out, and we want an easy fix-it guy. And let me tell you, God's not an easy fix-it guy, because there's something that He requires of me and you. And a lot of times we miss it. So let's not have selective hearing tonight. Amen. Let's listen to the Word of God and pay attention to it. Isaiah chapter 64 reads like this in verse 1. Oh, that you had rend the heavens and come down, and the mountains might quake at your presence. And when the fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, and that the nations might tremble at your presence. Man, you think Isaiah's praying for God's presence twice already, right? He says, I want to experience your presence. Look what he says in verse 3. He says, and when you did awesome things that we did not look for, you came down the mountains and they quaked at your presence. Man, three times Isaiah's saying it's about your presence. In desperation, listen, this is a prayer of desperation for Isaiah. It's a desperation for himself, but it's a desperation for the people of God. And Isaiah is begging for the presence of God. I want to see your presence. God, do it for your glory. Even when these people are not expecting it, do it for your glory, and may your presence be made known. Let me tell you, some of you today have come here for no other reason but just to show up to church. Can we say it like this? Are you invited? And you may not be looking for anything, but let me tell you, the one who thinks they need it the least needs the presence of God. And the one who thinks they need it the most, guess what? God will reveal Himself to you. I promise you this, but there's something that He's going to require from all of us. And Isaiah says, rend open the heavens, and may we feel your presence. Would you bow your head with me tonight? How many of you would say, that's my life, man. I feel like it's falling apart, and I need the presence of God. Man, I feel like my job's falling apart. I feel like my marriage is falling apart. I feel like my family's falling apart. I feel like my life's falling apart. I even feel sometimes like my church is falling apart, and I need the presence of God. Would you admit that tonight? For the one who says that they need the presence of God the least, I pray that God would show you something tonight when you're not even looking for it. Hey, would you pray with me? Father, we love you. We thank you for who you are. God, I just pray tonight that you would speak mightily for your name's sake. God, I know that in my life I've asked the question, where are you? God, I even spoke with a young lady last night who had asked those questions after she had gave her life supposedly to the Lord, and she finds herself asking the question again, where's God? Lord, I know many of us, we go through trials, and we hear your word says that consider it joy when we face trials of many kinds. And Lord, whenever we face trials as Christians, a lot of us question, why is it happening? How could it be? Why am I going through this? And God, why don't you just fix it? And Father, we know that it's to you to do a work in our hearts that we may seek your presence. And Lord, I just pray that, God, that we wouldn't come tonight just begging you to make it better, but God, we would come tonight begging for your presence, because your presence is power. And Lord, I pray tonight in desperation that a people would cry out for you, and they would cry out for the glory of God. Lord, we love you, and I pray tonight for a heart that's hard, Father. I pray that you would break it. Lord, I pray for a heart that's broken already, God, that by your grace and your mercy and your presence, God, that you would mend that broken heart. Lord, speak mightily tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Tonight, I'm going to preach a message called, I'm in Need of God's Power. I'm in need of God's power. In Isaiah chapter 64 and verse 1, you see Isaiah in the middle of his prayer for mercy of God, and he cries out, oh God, that you would rend the heavens and come down, and the mountains might quake at your presence. And there's a reason that Isaiah is praying this prayer for mercy. In Isaiah chapter 63, we'll dive into it in a moment. In Isaiah chapter 63, you find the subheading in your Bible may be the Lord's Day of Vengeance. In Isaiah chapter 63, quite simply, Isaiah is a book of prophecy. And so in this prophecy, what Isaiah is prophesying before people is literally Revelation chapter 19, what we know as the Battle of Armageddon. And he pictures Jesus coming as a mighty warrior, and his garments are stained with blood. If you read Revelation chapter 19, the Battle of Armageddon, that's exactly what happens in Revelation chapter 19, is the heavens will rend open, and when the heavens rend open, the mighty warrior Jesus Christ won't come as a peaceful man on a donkey, but he'll come as a warrior on a white stallion. And here's what happens in Revelation chapter 19. Literally, the sinners, those that have never placed their faith and trust in Christ Jesus, he will come with his breath, and it will be that sword that will bring his wrath on humanity. Dear friend, I don't want to experience that. Man, good mercy. I don't, man. I want to know the peace and the presence and the power of God. And in Revelation chapter 19, that's what happens. Think about this. Hebrews 4:12, the word is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword. And a lot of preachers like myself and evangelist Brother Kim will hike that verse up and go, man, the word of God will change you. In Hebrews 4:12, here's what that verse literally means. The word of God is what will bring wrath and judgment on a people. And in Hebrews chapter 4, it's all literally about persecution and judgment. In Hebrews, the whole book of Hebrews. And so in Hebrews 4, what he's saying is the word will decapitate you. It'll cut you. The word of God. Man, how will he bring his wrath? Literally, his breath. Literally, it's his breath. Revelation chapter 19, his breath will bring wrath. And listen, Isaiah sees this picture and sees this prophecy, and he's desperate that his people won't experience it. Y'all, he's desperate. He's desperate. He's saying, God, may your people not experience that type of judgment and wrath. God, may people not experience that kind of type of judgment and wrath. And I tell you, man, a lot of people have prayed for revival and prayed that God would do something in their heart and prayed that people would be saved. My church right now, I want you to know that I've got a guy that's praying and fasting today and tomorrow for you and for revival for my church coming up in April. Me and Christy had prayed and fasted twice already. Thursday was our day driving up here. Man, and here's what we're saying. God, I'm desperate for you to do something in my life. Can I just tell you? Man, I'm desperate for God to do something in my life. And literally, we'll find out in a moment whenever we pray and when we're fasting and whenever urges hit and different things, literally what we're asking God to do is, God, I need you more than food. God, I need you more than a TV. Lord, I need you more than Facebook. Amen. Some of you need to put it down. God, I need you more. I need you more. And what we're saying is, God, I'm desperate for your presence. Listen, Isaiah is desperate for the presence of God. And there's a reason that he's desperate, because he's experienced the presence of God, we'll find out in a moment, and he knows the hearts of the people. He knows that their hearts had rebelled against the covenant of God. In Isaiah chapter 63, in verse 10, he says, "But they rebelled and grieved his Holy Spirit." That the people had rebelled of the covenant of God, and they had grieved his Holy Spirit. Therefore, he turned to be their enemy, and himself fought against them. It's a picture of judgment, because they had grieved the Holy Spirit of God. And a lot of us in desperation will cry out and go, God, why don't you fix it? Why don't you hear my prayer? And there's a reason, because in our hearts, literally what we're saying is, God, I want you to fix whatever it is so I can keep going and my life will be okay. And the whole time what we're doing is we're grieving the Holy Spirit of God and his presence and power, because here's what it is, his presence is power. And listen, whenever the presence of God comes upon a person, they can't help but be changed. We talked about that last night. You can't help but be changed when the presence of God comes upon a person. And so he's desperate for God's presence. That's why he's praying in Isaiah chapter 63, the last portion, Isaiah chapter 64, because they had rebelled against the covenant of God. So Isaiah, he lifts up a prayer, a plea, a beg, whatever you want to call it, for one thing. And dear friend, you need one thing. This church needs one thing. Can I tell you, this country is in desperate need of the presence of God. We're in need of the presence of God. Revival is literally this. It is desiring God's presence. That's what revival is. Because whenever God's presence comes upon a person, there is a reviving, right? Now, our country is in need of a spiritual awakening. But God's people are in need of a reviving. Because our country will never experience a spiritual awakening until God's people have a reviving. And whenever there's a reviving in God's people, dear friend, there will be a great awakening, I believe, wholeheartedly. But it starts right here. In Isaiah's plea, he looks to God. In Isaiah 63, verse 15, just look at a few words with me. He's desperate. He says, look now from heaven. Look down from heaven. Verse 17. Return for the sake of your servants and the tribes of your heritage. Your holy people held possession for a little while. Our adversaries have trampled down your sanctuary. Return. Look down. Return. In verse 1 of chapter 64, he says, come down. He is desiring the presence of God. Look down. Return. Come down. The prophet Habakkuk says in Habakkuk 3, verse 2, O Lord, I've heard the report of you and your work. O Lord, do it in the midst of the year. In the midst of the years, revive it. In the midst of the years, make it known. In wrath, remember mercy. And that's what Isaiah sees, the wrath of God fixing to come upon a nation that has turned their back against God, who has rebelled against the Holy Spirit, the covenant of God. And he says there's a great wrath that's fixing to come. The people that don't know Jesus and have rebelled against his covenant, who are not walking in the ways of the Lord. When you get into Hebrews, it literally says this. He uses the wilderness generation throughout Hebrews. And he says, don't harden your hearts as they did in the rebellion. Why? Because man in exile, whenever their hearts were hardened, they didn't inherit the promised land. Wow. Can I tell you, there's going to be a many of people sitting in pews all across America who will not inherit the kingdom of heaven. Know what? Because of hard hearts, because selective hearing, because they didn't desire the presence of Almighty God. He gets to this moment in Isaiah chapter 64, and I just want to ask the question, does God desire revival? Does God desire revival? I would say Isaiah sure thought so. In Isaiah 64 and verse 1, "Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down, that the mountains might quake at your presence." He wants to know the presence of God like never before. And as a matter of fact, he'd already experienced that, and we'll talk about it in just a second. But he desired for people to know the presence of God. Isaiah wanted people to be overwhelmed at God's presence. And as when fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome things that we did not look for, you came down the mountains and they quaked at your presence. Man, he wants people to know the presence of God. Why did Isaiah want people to know the presence of God? Well, turn to Isaiah chapter 6 and let me fill you in on it, all right? Isaiah chapter 6, we know this section of Scripture. You hear it a lot, pastors preach it a lot. But there's something in here in this section of Scripture, a little nugget that I want to just kind of throw your attention at. Isaiah sure thought that there could be a great revival. In Isaiah chapter 6 and verse 1, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood the seraphim. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face, and with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called another and said," y'all read this with me, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts, and the whole earth is full of" what? "His glory." The whole earth is full of his glory. We sang just a while ago, just you talking about Revelation song. Man, you look in Revelation in that moment whenever the people of God that are raptured to heaven, that are in heaven, will bow before a holy God, and literally this is what they're saying. "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." Desperate for his presence. Desperate for his presence. Isaiah had never been shocked like this before. But whenever he was confronted with the presence of God, look what happens. Verse 4, "And the foundations of the threshold shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke." Isaiah pipes up whenever he experiences this presence like never before. And he says, "Woe is me. Woe is me. For I am lost. For I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Dear friend, whenever you're confronted with the presence of God, there's one thing that has to come up every time. Your uncleanness. Your uncleanness. See, whenever I was confronted with the God's presence at 21 years of age, July the 24th, 2002, and people say a lot of times, "Man, he says that a lot." Here's why. Y'all, I don't want to ever get over my salvation. It's not about a date. It's about being saved and know it. I don't ever want to get over my salvation. You know why? I want to be reminded of it all the time, because I don't want to go back to the old me. And the problem with a lot of us is we've done gotten over our salvation, and we're back to the old me, and we're comfortable there. And whenever Isaiah is confronted with the presence of God, he literally bows down and says, "Woe is me, for I'm an unclean man with unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of people in this unclean land." What he's saying is I'm a sinner. I'm a sinner. And my sin has separated me from you, O holy God. But in the midst of your presence, all I can say is I'm lost. I'm lost. Listen, if God shows up in your heart right now, the only thing that you can say is I am unclean and I need to be made new. And he says this, he says, "One of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hands a burning coal that he had taken from tongs from their altar. He touched my mouth and said, Behold, this has touched your lips, your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for." Quite simply, I'm not going to go into the theology of that, but whenever you're confronted with the presence of God and you confess your uncleanness before God and you're willing to turn from that, man, you'll be made clean. You'll be made clean. Promise that by the blood of the Lamb. So Isaiah has experienced the presence of God. I love the last part of that. Whenever the Lord says, man, who will go for us? Isaiah says, man, here I am, send me. And literally the Lord says, well, Isaiah, you're going to go into the midst of these unclean people and they're not going to hear, they're not going to listen, but you keep on. Isaiah doesn't give up. He keeps on proclaiming the truth of this holy God. And he keeps on striving. Listen, he keeps on striving for God's presence to be made known in his life, but the lives of people. He desires power and he desires God's presence. Isaiah chapter 64, verse 4. From of old no one has heard or perceived by ear, no eye has seen a God beside you who acts for those who wait for him. When you read verse 4, man, God is the only one that can revive you. And even people that are not looking for it, listen, God is the only one that can revive you. To be revived literally means to be back to life or to bring back to life. And no other God can do that. No other God can bring a people back to life. Can I tell you, no politician can bring a people back to life. There's no pastor that can bring a people back to life. There's no Sunday school teacher that can bring a people back to life. There is nobody that can bring a people back to life other than a holy God. And the only way that a people will ever be back brought to life is by the presence of God.
Yeah.
Verse 5, you meet him with joyful works, who joyfully works righteousness. Those who remember you in your ways. In verse 5, you meet him. Your presence meets him who joyfully works righteousness, who remembers you in your ways. Those who remember you in your ways. That joyful renewal to those who wait for him and receive his presence. In verse 12 of Isaiah chapter 64, he ends the prayer like this. I'm just going to kind of jump forward. He ends it. He says, will you keep silent and afflict us so terribly? Y'all, he still got this great battle on his mind, destruction, judgment. And he's saying, man, God, for your glory, would your presence be made known? God, don't keep silent. God, don't bring this affliction on the people. May your presence be made known. Here's why, y'all, because whenever God's presence reaches down and touches the people, makes himself known, there's going to be a great awakening, a great eye-opening. Does God desire revival? Man, Isaiah sure thought so. Let's ask ourselves this question then. Why is God not working wonders? Can I tell you, in some of us, he is, amen? In some people, God's doing a great work. It's my desire. I was sharing with a brother today. It's my desire. Y'all, September 2013, I'm going to tell you this story real quick. September 2013, as a pastor, I'm working a full-time job, going to seminary, taking about 3 to 4 classes or 2 to 3 classes, depending on what semester it is, and having a wife and 3 babies and everything else that goes with life. Man, I was just wore slap out. And I found myself, Brother Kim, I found myself during the week just preparing for Sunday morning. And man, I was convicted. The Holy Spirit of God convicted me. And I heard a pastor say this one time. He said, preacher, if you're not preaching on overflow, there's something wrong with your quiet time. And so September 2013, I had this spiritual discipline in my life that I allowed God to continue to work out in my life. And I said, you know what? I'm going to wake up 30 minutes early every morning. I'm going to get ready some mornings if I can. Not, I'm just going to go straight to the Word. And so every morning since September of 2013, man, I dive into the Word of God. I have a plan, and I work that plan, and then God begins to work in me. Don't forsake it. A few weeks ago, I said, well, if I can get up 30 minutes early, you know what? I can get 45 minutes early. And here's what I've never missed. I've never missed an ounce of sleep or an ounce of time. Because whenever God's presence shows up in you personally, you don't miss it. He redeems that time, dear friend. And a lot of us are so worried about 30 minutes extra sleep that we're missing the greatest blessing ever, and that's the presence of God. And we're wondering what's wrong, why God's not working wonders. Well, Isaiah knows. Isaiah knows it's because they had hardened their hearts. Isaiah knows that they had grieved the Holy Spirit. Isaiah knew that their sin had taken them away. had taken them on their own path. They had faded from the presence and the power of God. And Isaiah, in this prayer, he points out what's going on with these people. Look with me, Isaiah chapter 64 and verse 5, last part of it, he points out their sin. He says, "Behold, you are angry, and we sin. In our sins we have been a long time. Shall we be saved? We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a polluted garment. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities like the wind, they take us away." I just want to ask this question. This thought came to my mind. If our righteous deeds are like polluted garments, then what does our sin look like? Wow. And what does our sin look like? See, Isaiah points out their uncleanness. Can I tell you this? Sin dirties you, right? Sin dirties you. Sin takes you away. There's a saying that sin takes you further than you want to go, keeps you longer than you want to stay, and costs you way more than you want to pay. And it's an uncleanness. It dirties us. And whenever it dirties us, man, it truly blinds us. We're unclean. And Isaiah points it out. He says, "God, I know we've been there a long time. These people have been there a long time, and they are unclean. They're just flat filthy." Look what he says in verse 7. "There's no one who calls upon your name, who rouses himself to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have made us melt in the hand of our iniquities." Look what he says in verse 7. Don't miss this. "There's no one who calls upon your name." There's a people that he's saying is unconcerned with the presence of God. Dear friend, we would say it this way, where there's a lack of worry and interest about the name above all names. I would say this as well. It seems that our country is not concerned with the ways of the Lord. This country makes a mockery out of Christ. Can I tell you this? Church people seemed unconcerned as well. Church people seem unconcerned about a lost and dying world that's going straight to hell. And the church seems unconcerned. And here's what Isaiah says, and we've been there a long time. He brings up a third sin, Isaiah 64, verse 8. "But now, O Lord, you are Father. We are the clay, and you are our potter, and we are all the work of your hands." In verse 8, it's kind of a catch-22 word there, or verse there, if you will. He says, "In the past, they haven't been moldable, they haven't been pliable, they have resisted change." They've resisted change. Can I ask you this, and just get personal just for a few minutes? Has there ever been a time whenever you've resisted God changing your heart? You see, you want to know God, you want to know His presence, you say you want to know His power, but whenever it comes to your past, there's things that you just don't want to let go of, right? Don't want to let go of them. You're resisting that change. Now, I'm not knocking. I don't want you to become me, please, because I'm a sinner. I'm like Paul. I'm like the chief among sinners, right? I need God to continue to make me new and do work in my life. But I was talking with some buddies at work this week, and they were talking about cutting off their TV. And we haven't had TV in our house as far as cable or satellite. I live so far out in the boonies, they pipe in sunshine, man. We don't have internet. We got to get it on satellite to get it. That's the only way we can get internet at our house. And so we have satellite. And about 4 years ago, I would say, 3 or 4 years ago, I don't watch TV that much, and so we just took it off and had a guy come up to me, and his wife works in the church and back at home, and he said, "Man, I don't know what we would do if we cut our TV off." I said, "Man, I know exactly what you'd do if you cut your TV off. You would have the greatest free time ever, ever." He said, "Man, I don't know." I said, "Listen, whenever you let go of something that's trying to fill a void in your life and God begins to change your heart and you see what you've been missing out on for so long, you're going to wish you did it 3 years ago." But see, a lot of us, we resist change. You know why? Because we're comfortable. Because there's things that fill voids in our lives. And Isaiah says, and we've been there a long time, We've been there a long time. Let's ask this question then. Is there hope for revival? A hope such as Isaiah in verse 1. Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down. In verse 8, he says, but, that conjunction word. He says, but now, O Lord, our Father, we are the clay and you are our potter. And we are all the work of your hand. Isaiah knew that there was hope. He says, but now, these people, if they experience your presence, they are going to turn to God. Can I tell you this, man? There needs to be a desire to be molded, by the potter. Dear friend, clay can't mold clay. It falls flat every time. But when a great potter molds clay, man, he molds it into perfection. He says this in verse 9, but not so terribly angry, O Lord, and remember not iniquity forever. Behold, please look, we are all your people. And he's saying in this moment, but be not so terribly angry, O Lord, and remember not iniquity forever, that a people in forgiveness would, or crying out for God in forgiveness and repentance would be forgiven. And I praise God that God is a forgiving God. Amen. And you look at this moment, and he says, but we're going to be moldable. We're going to be pliable. We're going to cry out for forgiveness. In chapter 65, in verse 1, the Lord calls back to Isaiah in this prayer, and he speaks back to Isaiah, and listen to what he says. He says, I was ready to be salt, but those who did not ask for me, by those who did not ask for me. Listen to what he says. I was ready to be found by those who did not seek me. I said, here I am to a nation that is not called by my name. I spread out my hands all the days to a rebellious people who walk in a way that is not good, following their own devices. A people who provoke me to my face continually. And God's saying, and I was still giving them a chance. All the time in their rebellion, in their lack of wanting to know my presence, I was still giving them a chance. I'm going, here I am. And he says, and they never looked, they never sought, they never called out. Can I ask this question? What if God's hand was ready, but we were not seeking? What if God's hand was ready to fill your life with power, but you were not seeking? Dear friend, I believe God's ready. The question is, are we? I believe God's ready. The question is, are we? Are you ready to experience the presence of God? Do you find yourself like Isaiah, desiring to see God's power, desperate for God's presence, desperate for God to do a work in others' lives? I would say this then, man, our only hope is to rend our hearts. See, Isaiah in chapter 64, verse 1, he said, oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down. Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down. And the problem is, as a people, we want to say, oh, God, that you would rend the heavens and come down, and your presence would be made known, and I would feel good about myself, and everything would go great, and we would experience your peace, and we can continue to live the way we want to. And the whole time God's saying, you've never turned from sin. You've never turned from sin. You're asking for my presence, but you never literally turned to me. In Joel chapter 2, verse 12, listen to this. This is a great, great passage of scripture. If you want to even put in your Bible at the top of chapter 64, verse 1, listen to what Joel says. Chapter 2, verse 12. He says, yet even now declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart. See, the only way that we'll experience the true presence of God, the power of God, is when a people of God return their hearts to the Lord. Not just a portion of it, not just a small amount of it, not the part that we want God to fix, God to change, but he says all of it. All of it. Every bit of it. He says, with fasting, with weeping, and with mourning, and rend your hearts and not your garments. See, we want God to rend the heavens, but many of us are not willing to rend our hearts. That word rend means to tear apart, to open up, to let God have all of it. And we're saying, God, rend the heavens. And he's saying, rend your hearts. Rend your hearts. Listen, dear friend, many of us, we've been praying for God to do something in our hearts and in our lives, but yet we haven't acted upon it. A lot of us are saying, God, I want you to take this away from me. God, take this away from me. I don't want to have this desire. God, take this away from me. God, do this. And yet we haven't acted upon it. It's kind of like this. If I'm struggling, let's say, I don't want to be specific. Well, I guess I have to. Let's say I'm struggling with alcohol. I'm struggling with alcohol, and I'm saying, God, take this away from me. God, take this away from me. But the whole time I keep it in my refrigerator in a cooler and I never get rid of it. Man, why in the world is God going to take it away from me whenever I don't get rid of it? God, why don't you take this? I don't want to be addicted to pornography. God, I don't want to be addicted to pornography. Take it away from me. And the whole time we're praying that God would do something, but yet we're not willing to get rid of it. It doesn't make sense, y'all. He's saying, if you want me to rend open the heavens, I already have. I've called out. I've said, here I am, here I am, here I am. To rebellious people who have not sought me, who have not asked me, and all I want them to do is rend open their hearts. Rend open their hearts. Open it up, not their garments. It's interesting that word garments there. Whenever you look, he says rend their hearts and not their garments. The garments and the tearing of the garments, it was just an outward expression of a religious emotion. And can I tell you what, man, the worst thing that the church can do is get all emotional without changed hearts. You know what? We're going to go through emotional cycles over and over and over. Now, emotion's a good thing, but if that's all there is and there's no turning of our heart, we've all been messed up for a long time. But man, whenever there's the presence of God, one, you can't help but get emotional over the presence of God. But the presence of God should bring about a change of rending open our hearts, pouring it out, giving it all. And he says, return all of your hearts. Return to me with all your hearts, with fasting, with weeping, with mourning, and rend your hearts and not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for he is a gracious and merciful, slow to anger, amen, and abounding in steadfast love. In Isaiah, listen, Isaiah sees in chapter 63 this great battle of Armageddon that's fixing to fall on a people who don't desire the presence of God. And in Joel, what he's saying is this, is God, he relents over disaster. He mourns. Listen, God does not want to do it, but God's a just God. God doesn't want to do it. His desire is to save. His desire is his presence made known. His desire is that his presence brings power upon a people. That's God's desire, believe me. God's desire is that a people is saved, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. And Joel says, rend your hearts. Open up your hearts. In Matthew chapter 27 and verse 50 and 51, whenever Jesus was hanging on the cross, when he was giving his lifeblood for me and for you with a desire that we would rend open our hearts. When we rend open our hearts, man, Jesus literally, it's a picture here, he steps out of heaven and steps into a person's heart. Man, I'm thankful, listen to me, I'm thankful that Christianity is not a checklist. You know what I mean? Yep, went to church Sunday morning. Man, I get a double checklist. I even went Sunday night. Man, three, I even went Wednesday night with all 15 of them. Check. I don't know, I'm just guessing because that's the way it is in my church, Brother Kim. Don't guess. Right. Check. Well, I prayed three times this week and once every time before a meal. Check. Can I tell you what? Whenever God started doing a work in my home, and if I had time and I could talk about the presence of God doing the unthinkable in my life, man, me and my wife could go a long time, about how God's healed marriages, our marriage, how God's changed my life, how God's changed her life. And listen, it was because we were desperate. Desperate. I don't know if y'all have ever been there. Desperate for God to do something. Listen, I've been desperate for God to change my daddy for a long time. And I preached a revival here 2 years ago, and one night I asked everybody to take a cell phone out and come down to the altars and start texting people you love them. And I've been desiring for a long time that God would change my daddy, that he would rend open his heart and God would step in that change him. Man, I've been desperate for God to change people in my church. Brother Kim, you been there before? Desperate. Man, I've been desperate for people, literally. Just desperate. When Jesus was on the cross, and he was giving his lifeblood for you and me, last thing that happened whenever he cried out with a loud voice, the Bible says, verse 50, and Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. And behold, the curtain of the temple was torn in two. So what happened? It was rended. It tore. From top to bottom. And the earth shook. And the Bible says, and even the rock split. Rock split. And everything in one moment changed because of a rending, because of a tearing, because of a desperation from a holy God who desired to save people, desired to change them. A lot of us, we hear over and over every year the praying, or, you know, the flag, praying at the flagpole and asking God to change our country. And we always go to 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. You know it very well. My people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. Then I will hear from heaven. I'll forgive their sin and I'll heal their land. There's three things that God says in this section of Scripture. One, humble. My people who are called by my name, humble themselves. And pray, and listen, and seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways. Four things, humble, pray, seek, and turn from their wicked ways. Here's the conclusion. Then I will heal their land. I will forgive their sins. And then I will heal their land. And dear friend, listen to me. It's sad. It's sad whenever a people of God are not desperate to humble themselves before God. It's sad whenever a people of God are not desperate to seek God. It's sad, listen, whenever a people of God are not desperate to turn from their wicked ways. When we don't have a desire for God to do something in our hearts and our lives. Man, it's sad whenever the so-called people of God can't humble themselves enough to get along with one another. Can I ask you a question? Why in the world would a holy God come down and heal a church if we're not even desperate enough to act? Man. Why? I ask you tonight, are you desperate? Are you desperate for healing? Are you desperate for the power of God in your life? Are you desperate for forgiveness, for a cleansing? Are you desperate to be made right in relationship? Man, are you desperate for God to change your family dynamic? Are you desperate for God to change your church? Are you desperate for God to change your workplace? Are you desperate for God to change your school? Are you desperate for God to change your community? Are you desperate for God to change the churches around you? You know what? In relation to 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14, I asked my church this one time, why in the world would God heal our community whenever the churches can't get along with one another? Why would God heal a church when the people of God in the church can't get along with one another? Listen to me tonight. Have you ever been desperate for God to change your heart? Man, I tell you, July the 24th, 2002, I was desperate. I was desperate. Man, I was lonely. I was in a dark place. I saw my life of what it was fixing to come to. I had one of those Isaiah prophecy moments. And I saw what my life was fixing to be about 5 years down the road, and I didn't like it too much, and it scared me to death. You know why? Because I said I was never going to be like my daddy. And I said that I was never going to have a marriage like him and my mama. And then I figured out just in a moment by the Holy Spirit of God saying, well, that's where you're headed, son. And it scared me. And y'all, whenever God asked me those questions, do you know if you die today that you'd go to heaven? And in my selective hearing over the years, I began to justify every decision that I ever made. I had to stop. And listen, there's going to come a time where you can't justify your life anymore. Can't justify it. And there's going to come a time in your life where the only thing that you're going to be able to say is, prayerfully, God save me. God save me. God save me. You see, I can't work my way to heaven. I can't be good enough. I can't pretend to know it all. I can't look for everything to fill my void. And then one day, listen to me, one day, say these words, I wished I would have paid attention. I wished I would have paid attention. Because the desperation, dear friend, is going to be too late. The desperation is going to be too late. So let me ask you this. Have you ever been desperate for God to save you? For God to change you? Have you ever been desperate for God to do a work in your heart, to make you new every day? Have you ever been desperate for God to bring about forgiveness in your home, healing, reconciliation, to change it around? Man, let me tell you, I know without a shadow of a doubt there's some of you sitting here today that's saying, man, I'm desperate. I'm desperate that God would change my spouse. Let me ask you this. Do you think God wants to change you too? Why would God change your spouse if you're not willing for Him to change you? I'm desperate. How desperate are you? Man, every head bowed and every eye closed. I'm going to just ask Cole just to come along. I'm just going to ask Cole to come along. And I'm just going to ask him to pray or just to play just a little bit.